You're so far away.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. So, hello, is it hello?
Hello.
Hello. This is, today is the, I don't even know.
Today is the 23rd.
Today is the day before Mark Sargent's birthday. Yay! And what are we doing? We are celebrating post Flat Earth Day Mixer event in Seattle.
Yep.
What do we do with this energy? And what do we do when we come together to have an impact, to make the world a better place, and to make ourselves better people in a better world?
Yeah, we should do that. The point is, you can't have more cake. And that's what it appears to be. But that's the only way you can do it.
We had a great time. Yay!
We did. It was fantastic. You guys should have all been there.
And so I'm going to now ask Mark a few questions, and I'm going to switch my camera around. This is not the most flattering look anyway, so that's a good choice. And now I'm looking at my own face. Hello, Mark.
Hi.
Happy Flat Earth Day Mixer post event.
Yes.
So tell us, what was the highlight of the event for you?
The highlight of the event for me was just meeting everybody. It was really, really great. People that came in from out of state, from Oregon and Idaho and California, we gave out gifts.
This is what you get.
That's awesome.
I feel like Vanna.
Letter blues.
Oh, what?
We had cake, Flat Earth cake. Robin Poe brought some. Sasha, of course, shot video, which was really, really great. And just got to meet so many fantastic people. And everyone had their own stories about how they got into Flat Earth, but more than anything else, it was this feeling of community where finally people were saying, people that emailed me every single day and said, look, there's nobody to talk to about this, nobody to talk to about this. Now there's people to talk to.
I feel happy.
Yay! And how drunk did you get?
Not as drunk as you might think. It was, there was quite a few, there was a lot of spirits flowing around, that's for sure. Hopefully everybody got a safe drive home.
And how drunk did Orphan Red get?
Orphan Red was quite inebriated, to the point where I don't know if she was even making much sense.
You think so?
She was slurring in French, she was slurring in some sort of Canadian dialect that I'm not even sure is used anymore. No, she was great. Orphan Red was fantastic, and if you see the video, you'll notice she was in her princess, her yellow princess dress.
Did that go over well with the fans?
It did.
I feel like Vanna.
Orphan Red walking around in sparkly yellow, you know, canary yellow satin, was it?
Yes.
Canary yellow satin. A lot of fun.
The youngest guest was Langston.
Oh, right. That was really fun.
Yeah, he was super cute.
Yeah, we had a neat group of people. Everybody had fun. We stayed and ran the room from, 5 o'clock all the way through 9:30, 4.5 hours.
Yay! Mark and I were in the middle of talking about fallen angels and the goal, the purpose of what we're doing here.
Oh.
In the system?
Yeah. The Bob acronym, which Earth stands for Educational Avatar Reality Training Habitat. For me, that's what it really is. In fact, when I was talking with that Mason the other day, when he was saying how it's interesting that when they always teach the Masons that the Solomon's Temple is the representation of the universe, and I come back and said, no, it's more than that. Solomon's Temple is the universe, meaning the whole universe. If you can build like a giant planetarium, the planetarium doesn't have to be dome shaped; it could be square shaped or rectangle shaped. And so, when they teach the Masons this for years and years and years, centuries, as a matter of fact, they didn't have all the pieces to the story. The final pieces were just recently discovered with our advanced technology, because we're starting to do this now. So when they talk about, again, the Solomon's Temple being a representation of the universe, I see it as a physical place, no different than a giant holodeck or a giant matrix. Neil deGrasse Tyson, you know, talked about that just the other day, where he came out and said, against other physicists, and said that virtual reality is very, very possible. And for me, this is an educational process. It is a game, it is a ride, it is all these things wrapped into one giant, really, really slick and well-presented package. So the Fallen Ones, when they talk about the angels and Lucifer and everything that's going on there, I was going, look, it's another layer to the story. This story, this tapestry that we are in right now is so rich and so deep. We get lost in the details. We form entire religions off the details. But it's still part of the story. You know, it's like no different than going into a planetarium and seeing a meteor shower. And you're thinking, oh, this meteor shower looks fantastic. It's all this wonderful. Yeah, but it's still just a meteor shower inside the planetarium. All the drama that you're seeing unfold there is just still part of the story. Imagine if you could write layers and layers and layers of storyline into this place. How much more rich you could make it. And so for me, the Fallen Ones, the whole Lucifer storyline, you know, taking a third of the angels, then interfering with human beings, you know. But even some of those stories were great because they took into account the flat Earth model. Like when Lucifer supposedly took Jesus to the top of the highest mountain and showed him the entire, you know, all the breadth of the world. Yes. You can't do that on a globe. So where did he take him that he could show him this very, very high place? There's been different, even the famous story, I think it was a Norse story, the Smoky God talks about an underground race of people and the king of the earth is down there. This giant, you know, imposing figure that leads this advanced technology and this advanced group. Who else would be the king of the earth, king of the world?
And so if this is a simulated environment, and one of the purposes of its design is to allow us to learn a few things, expand our horizons, maybe work on the sharp corners, the sharp edges of who we are in order to better ourselves. And so that after this, we can better appreciate what comes next.
Yes.
Then what are some of the better choices that we can make while we're here to, I guess, better serve that purpose?
Well, it's a double-edged sword, because in most game simulations, whatever you want to call it, you try to make it better. You try to just make it better every time around. But with this place, if what's outside here, and I firmly believe this, it's an unlimited universe. If anyone wants to take a gander, that look at the woodcut known as the Flammarion from 1888, I believe. When you're looking at that, if this is an unlimited universe outside of this, we were meant to suffer here. And steal the line from Agent Smith, which was human beings define their reality through misery and suffering, which is why the Matrix was redesigned to this, because the first versions didn't go very well because we apparently thrived on conflict. We thrive on the struggle, which is so evident with us anyway. It's our biggest weakness, which is if we don't have a unified cause, we immediately create the cause and the drama when there isn't. Think I'm kidding. Look at the old mother's trick, where if the baby isn't crying, you can poke the baby and make it cry so that you can help it get back to sleep. Why did they start that drama in the first place? We are suffering here because it's unlimited out there. So the only way you can appreciate an unlimited universe is to live in a very, very constrictive, limited one. And by that I mean, you have to create. There is no light without shadow. There is no pain without pleasure. You can't appreciate something without having an opposite or losing it. And that's what this place appears to be. It is a world of almost inescapable conflict. You can try. Even if you were born with the most fantastic genes, you were the richest, most athletic, most attractive, and the best actor, and all these other things. If you could accomplish all these things, you still have to deal with mortality, or your friend's mortality, or your friend's mortality, or all the world that is constantly decaying and changing around you and creating more conflict. You never, you know, it's especially with human beings, it's inescapable. We cannot escape the conflict that is around us, which always struck me as, well, of course, that's because you can't, how can you, not to use too oversimple a term, but how can you appreciate heaven without at least taking a glimpse at hell?
So what happens then to those who are seeking to upload their consciousness into artificial intelligence of some sort in order to...
escape?
Well, is it escaping or is it in order to reach immortality here? So that it's kind of the opposite of escape then, because are they not trying to figure out a way to stay in the program instead of cycling back out?
You could try to do that, but I don't believe... I've said this on other things. Mm-hmm. I don't believe that we are going to be allowed to create a 13th floor scenario. The Matrix was a little different because it was one level of the Russian stacking doll argument. But the 13th floor was a civilization which creates a virtual reality, and that virtual reality, some of the characters create a virtual reality.
Okay.
And so that you can go even deeper. Inception sort of touched on that, dreams within dreams within dreams. But it's true. You once you do that, then you're kind of dodging, you're going down. You're going down, but again, you still have to deal with the mortality of your consciousness. Unless you can upload your consciousness as an algorithm, and to date, I don't think we've even really touched on that. I mean, there's too many organic pathways, and there's that mystical, magical thing that goes on there, which we still don't know. Yeah, we can simulate neurons, but not the artificial, the sentience that goes along with what's up in our heads. So... I don't think we're going to be allowed to do it. I think civilizations, once they reach a certain point, once they get close to it, I think that's part of the triggers that kills this place. Nah, I don't say kill and like, oh, we're going to drown again or burn or a big rock's going to fall on us. I mean that it eventually reaches its conclusion, one way or the other.
And so when we walk into this world from the limitless universe outside... we come in with a blank slate, but do you think that we bring in echoes of memories of technologies or options or things that are available in that broader world?
Well, you don't want to bring too much. I mean, you might bring a couple echoes, but there's a saying, and some people call it a dead metaphor, which is you can't have your cake and eat it too. And that really, yeah, it doesn't make sense, because if you had your cake, you could very well eat it too. What they mean is, you can't have your cake, eat it too, and still have your cake, because you ate it. See what I mean? It just, you can't have both. But what that means, though, is...
So then shouldn't, sorry, I'm interrupting. Shouldn't it then be, you can't eat your cake and have it too?
Yeah, it should be that. The point is, you can't have more cake. All right.
No cake for you.
The point is, you can't be fooled again. So, fool me once, shame on
George Bush.
Shame on you. So, no. The problem is, you can't. We'll apply it to where we are now. You can't live this life, remember the life that you had, and still live this life with the same enthusiasm. Because it doesn't mean anything to you. There's no, you have no stake in it. There's no risk.
Yeah.
It's going on. It's the Bill Hicks analogy, which was, I took it a little further than Bill Hicks, where he said that you're on a ride, and you shouldn't be scared because you're on a ride. The track's never going to move. You're on this ride. You're going to get off it. Well, that's fine and dandy. But what he didn't tell you was, what if you woke up on that ride? What if you all of a sudden had amnesia and you woke up on a roller coaster that was doing, you know, that was slowly climbing up this hill? Every twist would be, you know, soon, you know, eventual death. Every turn you'd be screaming because you had no idea what was going on. And that's what it appears to be. But that's the only way you can do it. You can't do both. You can't leave even the smallest sliver of a memory. I'll give you an example. I thought of this years ago, which was, let's say you had the ability to go to the unlimited dimension and record 30 seconds of footage and release it on YouTube. Think of the chaos that thing would cause. If you showed, you know, and granted, you know, the resolution wouldn't be perfect, you know, because who knows what resolution, they're probably using Mandelbrot resolution in that dimension. But think of all, the people that would, once you showed them proof, here's the reason why religions are kind of stuck in this quandary. Once you show somebody that there's actually proof of an afterlife, and that may or may not be penalty for going there willingly, people just start running off bridges, throwing themselves into traffic.
Yes.
If their life sucked even in the slightest, I'll use, you know what, I'm going to use a game analogy for you. And here is, there was a game some years ago called StarCraft, the original StarCraft. And there was an online version of that game where you could play multiplayer games with people, you know, two or three people playing in this multiplayer game. StarCraft was a strategy game. But the problem of that game was, is that people, once that, because you can figure out, in strategy games, you can kind of figure out how the ebbs and flows are going pretty quick. So if your game, if you're going to lose, and it's still going to take you 20 minutes to lose, why are you still playing? You don't play. You jump out of that game. There's no penalty for jumping out of the game, which there wasn't. People just abandon games in droves. It's like, yeah, I'm going to lose. You know, I'm going to lose. People just quit games all the time. That was the whole most horrible thing about the online part of that game. Same thing with this place. If you knew you could go to we'll use heaven. If you could go to heaven without a penalty, you know, before, you gotta remember, it was 400 years after the Bible was even published before they made suicide a cardinal sin.
That's right.
Because of the suicide cults to try to slow them down, and it worked. But if there was no penalty for suicide and you knew there was an afterlife, oh, it's life as we know it would completely change. No one would take it as nearly as seriously as they would. It's like, things get hard, I'm out. You know, I'm out. So that's why you put this doubt. You can't let, to date, I'll make this point a little clear. To date, no one has died, and don't use the Jesus argument on me, because we're talking mortal people here. No one has died and come back to talk about it. And for only one of two reasons, either they can't or they won't. And it might be both. You know, if this place is just a fragment, just a tiny fragment of the unlimited universe that's out there, why would you come back in the slightest? It's not even worth your time. Well, are you going to come back and tell people what's going on out there? You'd ruin everything. There's probably rules in place. There's probably protocols in place to stop you from doing it. So, there you go.
Do you have any questions? Because I'm blanking.
Oh, that's okay. We did quite a bit. Did you have fun during your thing? During the event?
Such a demand, you can hold it to the best. I had a great time. It was really nice to meet everyone.
Yep.
Oh, where am I looking?
We're going to get you out of that backlight.
Oh, right. I had a wonderful time. It was really great to meet everyone. And Rob and Poe, the initiative to start this, to organize it, was wonderful. JL Forbes was there. Met some new people who aren't doing videos yet, but everyone's kind of getting excited at the idea of starting to become content creators for Flat Earth videos soon on YouTube. So I had a wonderful time.
Cool.
Yay.
It's fantastic. You got any new projects coming up?
No. I do not.
You're a little tired from the event, aren't you?
I am tired from the event. It was wonderful, but yeah, I'm tired. And also, I think that the Flat Earth movement, has excitement, has buzz, and now that we're starting to meet up, there's this community, and I really think we need to focus on what do we do with this energy, and what do we do when we come together to have an impact, to make the world a better place, and to make ourselves a better people and a better world.
Nice.
Yay! Sparkles now!
That's great.